Good morning, student. This is Pranish Shukla, and today I am going to resume the chapter Law Spring. Okay, so let's begin. The chapter has been authored by or written by Anish Jung, and she is an Indian English writer. So already I had given you a little bit glimpses of the chapter. So we have to begin from this paragraph. So I just explain from there. I remember a story of a man from Udupi once told me. Udupi is a place in South India, Kerala. So Anish Jung says that once she was told a story by a man as a young boy. So the man, when he was a young, he would go to school. So he used to go to school, passed by an old temple. So when he was going to school, or he went to school that time, there was an old temple. So he passed by there, where his father was a priest. So the man who was telling a story, he himself went past by the old temple. His father was a priest there. He would stop for a while at the temple and pray for a pair of shoes. The boy was so poor that he could not even afford a shoe. He was the son of priest, and priest himself was the father in that particular temple. So he would stop briefly at the temple and pray for a pair of shoes. 30 years later, now she says, Anish Jung says, 30 years later, I visited his town and the temple. So Anish Jung visited the town. And what she saw, she saw that which is now drawn in an air of desolation. Now this town has been a little bit, backward, or the town seems to be not that much progressive, and most of the generation or the people or the crowd of the town has been either shifted or left this place like an isolated area. So which was now drawn in an air of desolation. Air of desolation means now this town has been a little bit alone, isolated, and most of the people in the town are not living there now. They have either migrated to different cities. In the backyard, where lived the new priest? So Anish Jung says that in the backyard, now the new priest was living there after 30 years. There were red and white plastic chairs. Young boy also was there. He suddenly came. He was wearing a uniform, a dress, gray uniform, socks and shoes. Specifically notice, now the boy was wearing socks and shoes. He is a schoolboy. Before that, 30 years before, there was a schoolboy, son of priest. He went to school, he prayed to the God, and now Goddess has granted the prayer possibly, and she has given the shoes. Arriving panting and threw his school bag on a folding bed. So he arrived. Arrive panting means he is gasping, he is out of breath, and threw his school bag on a folding bed. So there was a bed, it was a folding kind of bed. So he threw his school bag. So Anish Jung, when look at the boy, she suddenly again recollected or rememorized the particular story when the schoolboy was the person who told a story. When he was a kid, he went to school and he made a request or prayer to the goddess that get me the shoes. And finally, a schoolboy is there who has got the shoes. Now you will say, what's the connectivity there? That boy were different, this boy is different, but let's see some more. Let me never lose them. The boy, when had finally got the shoes, he also had prayed to the goddess that let me never, my generation should also get the shoes. Means now I should never lose the shoes. The boy also said that the goddess had granted his prayer, and possibly got it. Goddess had granted the prayer that he would never lose his shoes. So Anish Jung says that the man had told her the story that he requested God to give me the shoes. He prayed God and finally got the shoes. When he got the shoes, he also requested the God. He prayed the God that I should never lose the shoes. And now they are still with the shoes. The son of priest. The young boys, like the son of priest, now wore shoes. So now priest son prayed, priest son wearing. Right? So the particular section, like priest section or high society section of the society, is wearing shoe. But many others, like the rag pickers in my neighborhood, remain shoeless. But many others, like rag pickers, are in my neighborhood remain shoeless. So Anish Jung says that a particular section of the society has become a little bit developed, that they are wearing shoes. But there is also a kind of section who are always shoeless. They are the part of the society. Though they are Bangladeshi, but they are the society of India. And they are living, and not only these Bangladeshi, but yes, there are a lot of people. Thousands of people are there, millions of people are there who are remain shoeless. Now next paragraph. So this was a story which is satirically about the the difference between classes of society. My acquaintance with barefoot rag pickers. In the next paragraph, Anish Jung says that my familiarity with the barefoot rag pickers leads me or directly drives me to Simhapuri, a place on the periphery or the outskirts of Delhi. So Simhapuri is a place, must remember all the students please, yet miles away from it. Simhapuri is a place that is around Delhi, that is outskirts of Delhi. Okay, so close to Delhi, but miles away from it metaphorically. Metaphorically mean in a figurative sense. What is a figurative sense? When literal meaning is shifted to a little bit broader meaning. We call it a figurative. Okay, so let's see some more. Delhi is at the periphery. Sorry, Simhapuri is at the periphery of Delhi, yet miles away. Means Delhi is a progressive developing area, while Simhapuri is in a backward situation, in a backward area. So well, they are very close, yet miles away in their development, in their progress, in their flourishing, in their thriving, etc. Those who live here are squatters, and the people who are living there in Delhi at Simhapuri, they are the squatters, they are the refugees. They are the very poor people who came from Bangladesh back in 1971. So these families who are now living in Simhapuri, they are the people from Bangladesh who shifted in India, who migrated to India in 1971 and settled down in different parts of India as per their comfortability and comfort zone. Sahib's family is among them. So Sahib's family is also one of those people from Bangladesh. Simhapuri those days was a wild area. Okay, so those days Simhapuri was not very developed. Still it is not developed. It is written further. It is still is, but it is no longer empty. So still Simhapuri is a wild area, completely backward area, but it is no longer empty. That time possibly before 71 it was empty. Mostly people will not living there, would not be living there, but now it is a place which is saturated with the activities of the poor people. In structures of mud, so there are structures of mud, roofs are there of tin and tarpaulin material, devoid of sewage, so it's completely crowded with the sewage or the dirt or shabby water collection and gathering of garbage, etc. Drainage or running water, so drainages are there. Most of the drainages of the cities are also having their openings in this area. Running water is there, and around 10,000 rag pickers live. They have lived here for more than 30 years. These rag pickers have spent more than 30 years there in Simhapuri. They have no identity. They have no permits, but only have ration cards. Ration cards give them or allow them to put their name on the voter list and enable them to buy green. So they are voters. Especially they are voters, so they are an advantage for political parties, and they also purchase grains and so on. Food is more important for survival than an identity. If at the end of the day we can feed our families and go to bed without an aching stomach, we would rather live here than in the fields that gave us no grain. Say a group of women in tattered sarees. When I ask them why they left their beautiful land of green fields and rivers. It's a very long sentence, so I took a little bit time there, but let's explain. Let's study. Anisjan, when interacting a group of women, the women was in a very tarnished, wearing sarees, and they are very poverty-stricken, grinding in situation. So when Anisjan asked them, why you left your Bangladesh? Bangladesh is a beautiful, beautiful place, Dhaka. It's a full of green and a lot of landscape, like things are there. It's very naturally gifted. So those women answered her. They say, food is more important for survival than an identity. So they say that food is more important, not identity. We are native of Bangladesh. We have our acknowledgement and recognition there. But we have no food and opportunities to survive. And that's why we will live here, which is providing us basic, most basic thing, the food. If at the end of the day, we can feed our families, we can give food our families, and we can go for sleep without an aching stomach, means we are full of our saturated or we are satiated in our foods. So why we will go at a place which where we are not having food? So it is all about the food, and they have a fine opportunity to have a fine dinner. What should I say? Well, meal. They have a fine meal there. That's why we would rather live here than in the field that gave us no grain. So the women group says that if we are having our bread and butter in this area, why we shall live there? There is no point in that. Why they left? So I ask them when they left their beautiful land of green fields and rivers. So this was the answer of the ladies when Anisjan asked them why they left. Wherever they find food, they pitch in their tents. So wherever they get an opportunity for survival, they pitch in, or they settle down, they arrange their tents and become transit home. Those tents are their temporary homes. Children grow up in them, children are born, children are brought up, they are grown up in those tents, becoming partner in survival. They become the partner in survival, and survival in Simapuri means rag picking. And what is the mean of survival in Simapuri? It is all about picking off the rags. Through the years, it has acquired the proportions of a fine art. Through the years means with the passage of time, now those people who are picking the rags, they also got a kind of a skill to find out where they can have the better rag, where they not. Garbage to them is gold. For the rag pickers, garbage has so much value that it is like a gold. Gold means something that is very valuable. It is a metaphorical expression. Gold means so useful, like gold for a common person. It is their daily bread, it is their livelihood, a roof over their head, it is their shade, it is their shelter. Even if it is a leaking roof, even if it is a poor shelter, it's a broken shelter, but for a child it is even more. But for a child, it is a little bit sufficient. Let's go further. I sometimes find a rupee, even a 10 rupee note, Sahib says. Sahib-e-Alam says that, sometimes I find a 10 rupee note. His eyes are so much confident and lighting up. When you can find a silver coin in a heap of garbage, you don't stop scrounging. For a perspective of a child, it is not only a mode of survival, but it is also a kind of game and sport. Sahib scrounges in the garbage for gold. Gold means for the survival, for the money. And sometimes whenever he gets a 10 rupee or 1 rupee or 2 rupee note, he becomes so much excited because it's like an incentive for an employee. So there is a hope for finding more. So it also gives the encouragement for the children. Children are completely ignored, unaware what they are facing these days or when they are rag picking. They even don't know how much already they have been burdened and exploited. So it's just like a game and take it easy they do. It seems that for children, garbage has a meaning different from what it means to their parents. So garbage is different. Garbage has a different meaning for the children and for the parent. For the children, it is wrapped in wonder. For the children, it is something like a surprise box. And for the elders who are mature, who know the reality of their life, it is just a survival. They know that without this, they cannot survive. Let's see. Next paragraph. One winter morning, I see Sahib standing by the fence gate. So Anish Jung says, casually, again she saw Sahib-e-Alam, he was standing by or close the fenced gate, a gate which was fenced, surrounded by the walls or woodworks of the neighborhood club. So there was a club in the neighboring area, in the vicinity, watching two young men dressed in white playing tennis. So there were two boys, they were playing tennis. Sahib-e-Alam, he was also tempted to play, but he was so poor that he could not even have the courage to go there, and no money he had so that he could take the membership of the club. I like the game, he hums. He hums mean only he murmurs. He murmurs, he speaks in a very suppressed tone that I want to play the game, I like the game. But he's satisfied to watch it standing behind the fence. But when he is watching this game only by standing nearby the fence, he says that it is only the satisfaction that he is getting there. He has no opportunity, but he is satisfied with that only. I go inside when no one is around. Sahib-e-Alam is saying, when there is no one around, I go inside. He is talking to Anish Jung. He admits, the gatekeeper lets me use the swing. Lets me mean allows me to use the swing. Swing means, you know, a kind of jhula, a kind of swinging, sportive, you know, arrangement of, you know, chairs and particular, completely, you can say, an entertaining kind of tool or entertaining kind of arrangement or something. Sahib too is wearing tennis shoes that look strange over his discolored shirts and shorts. Sahib-e-Alam is wearing the shoes, which are tennis shoes. They are very strange kind of shoes, you know why? They are discarded shoes, they are discolored shoes. Sorry, yes, he's wearing shirt and short also. Someone gave them to me, he says in a manner of an explanation. When Anish Jung looked at the shoes of tennis shoes of Sahib-e-Alam, so Sahib-e-Alam noticed that Anish Jung curiously looking at the shoes. So he naturally answered or explained that I have got these shoes somewhere, or someone has given these shoes to me. Okay, so here I am again going to end this session, and in the next part I am going to explain the full chapter. If you have any doubts, so comment me, and you can send me also any information on my Telegram or WhatsApp number. Thank you very much. Have a nice day.